any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. Put another way, the technology that empowers us today makes us gods in the eyes of our ancestors. But there's still that one little thing we have. Is it better now? Can I stop it? There's still that one little thing we haven't got covered. You see, God created man in his own image. Can we create machines that can think and live and feel like we do? It's called the singularity, the point where artificial intelligence in a computer reaches that of human intelligence. AGI, or artificial general intelligence, is the currently hypothetical machine that can perform any task that a human can. And it isn't a new concept. We've known about AGI since at least the 1950s, and it still remains unsolved over 60 years later today. And the thing is, what we do know is that if we do solve it, it will be one of the biggest, most important technological revolutions we've ever seen. So the interesting question now is, how far have we come? So what I'm going to try and do now is what's essentially summarizing decades of progress we've made in the field. You see, in the beginning, when computing systems first came into play, we were for the first time able to describe to a computer how to perform a task. We did this by taking our knowledge of how to perform the task and breaking it down into a set of simple instructions that a computer can follow. And this, although led to the software revolution, it still leaves us far from actually getting us a step closer to AGI, because what we learned the hard way is that although there's all these tasks, that there's a whole class of problems which we find trivial, but it's extremely difficult to break it down into a set of intuitive ideas that you can elaborate to a computer. For instance, determining if that cat's hungry. Does it look hungry? Yes, humans are supposed to be intelligent. Does that cat look hungry?
Yes.
What about this one?
Yes.
Yeah? So there's something about that picture, because remember, it's just an arrangement of pixels on a screen, and yet there is a mathematical relationship that between that picture and the hungriness of a cat. And the thing is that there's no way we could have figured out what that relationship is, because the relationship is a whole stack of formulas. I literally printed it out. It's a 10-page formula. And there's no way a human could have figured that out. And that's where machine learning comes into play. Because machine learning works on the philosophy that rather than trying to break down a task into every task, and take every task and break it down into a set of instructions that a computer can follow, why not instead put your effort into describing to the computer one task, the task of how to learn those rules from examples. Besides, that's how we as humans have been learning for a long time. And there's a particular form of machine learning called artificial neural networks, which has shown some amazing results recently. What's special about them is that they're inspired by how neurons in a brain works. And the thing is, we're now starting to be able to replicate more and more parts of the human brain. And this is essentially biomimicry, but with the creation of a mind. So, for example, we've been able to replicate the visual cortex enough to be able to find cases where these algorithms are now starting to beat us at a growing number of cases. Like, not all of us could have figured out that that's a crab, and we would have been distracted by all the people and not noticed the reels. And these are the actual image quality we give to the algorithms. And so we've even been able to go on to other parts of the brain, like the auditory cortex, responsible for speech recognition and speech synthesis.
The Blue Lagoon is a 1980 American romance and adventure film directed by Randall Kleiser.
That was not a human recorded voice. That was the result of an AI that learned to mimic the human voice just by looking at the raw audio waveforms of the sounds we make. And the thing is, even in 2014, there was a chatbot that was successfully able to convince 33% of the judges that it was human by masquerading as a 13-year-old Ukrainian boy. And we're even going to more fundamental parts of the brain, like the human reward system, responsible for things like your desires and your motivations. And by training AI systems, by getting them inherently to be addicted to rewards, and by rewarding them for the right behavior, we're now able to train them to be able to beat us at a growing number of tasks involving hand-eye coordination, logical reasoning, puzzles, and it's just growing. So all this is just the tip of the iceberg. Trust me, there's a whole lot going on in the field that just can't be fit into a TED talk. But we're starting to divide and conquer more and more parts of the human brain. But we're still far from creating that one single system that can learn to perform any task, every task that a human can. They're all good at a specific task that we can perform, not everything. So the thing is, the reason for that is when you're trying to mimic something as complex as the human brain, it was created by evolution, who's a million years ahead of us. And millions of years of evolution has resulted in this amazingly complex web of networks in our brain. And I even go as far as saying that even by a miracle we were suddenly given the solution to AGI, chances are we won't understand it. It will be simply too elaborate and complex, just as the rules for determining cat hungriness. And that is that where the pattern emerges. Just like we got machine learning algorithms to be able to learn the rules of cat hungriness, which is pretty useful, but still gets us pretty close to AGI, why not go a step further and get machine learning algorithms to learn the task of artificial general intelligence? That is, and remember, artificial general intelligence itself is the task of learning to perform tasks. So in essence, create a machine learning algorithm capable of learning how to learn. And this, it has resulted in a whole class of new types of algorithms that's got us that much closer to solving AGI. And that's where we stand today. So now you know what it means to engineer a mind. You know that it's a difficult problem, but one worth solving. And hopefully you've got some idea of where we stand today on this amazing problem. But from my brush with this extraordinary field, there's something else I found. I found an idea that can give us the opportunity to have a profound impact on our lives starting today. You can seize, it's something that you can seize today. And I know this because just 3 years ago, everything I knew about AI, all I knew about AI was what you'd see in Hollywood. And what happened between just three years ago and now is that I saw a team come together, a team of individuals with a diverse set of passions, from mechanics to electronics to computer science. And the thing is, what we had in common was the common inspiration by Hollywood's portrayal of AI and the common naive belief that the only thing stopping us is not trying. So we just pulled in a bunch of our pocket money and we started with the intelligence level of a cockroach. And we started moving on to more and bigger problems, to the point where we started tackling problems for which solutions don't exist in books yet. Because what happened is, our passion was contagious because we started building a global network of sponsors. And today, I'd like to introduce you to, for the first time, what I think may be the only semi-autonomous car built exclusively by undergraduates. And meet Eve. As of just last week, she's capable of level 2 autonomy. So what I want to share is what it is that inspired us, that took us through every day of this amazing journey. And maybe it can lead to a journey like that for you. It boils down to two things I learned about the field. two things that I recognize that I think you can only recognize when you actually get into the field. One is that we are extremely lucky to be at this point right now where there's been many numerous different driving factors that actually very suddenly happened to happen in our generation. And for example, one of the driving factors is that we're now starting to create new types of processors that are capable of, that were built from the ground up for modern machine learning algorithms. And the thing is, it's allowed people, even people like me, to build and assemble my own homemade supercomputer built for AI. And it's not like it costs that much because of modern technology. It's even possibly going to allow us to actually power the very hungry meta-learning algorithms that are not too practical as of today. The second thing is that this field has an unusually low prerequisite knowledge. For example, and this has allowed one of our members of the team to win the best research paper award by one of the most prestigious international academic publishers. And then another thing is the unusually low prerequisite knowledge. And aside from that is the unusually high degree of open sourcing in the field. Because today, you can actually build on top of the same software built by multi-billion dollar software companies. And all of this has driven what I think is the most important factor, ease of experimentation. Because what happened is just a few, recently, I had a hunch, just a hunch, that you can measure creativity by measuring the lack of boredom, which you can approximate to predictability. And within literally 6 hours, I was able to get a bunch of arms to learn how to dance creatively and unique to one another. And another thing is that some of the most impressive ideas in the field are actually started off seeming very counterintuitive and verging on stupidity. For example, who would have guessed that just deleting and killing neurons in an artificial neural network actually increases the performance and robustness of these networks? And that brings me to the second thing I recognize about this field. It's that this field is not only an amazing opportunity for us, it's also an even bigger opportunity for the young minds of today. Because there's this unique interaction between AGI and the mind of a child. What I mean is, to compensate for the lack of knowing anything about the world, the mind of a child is actually one of evolution's most powerful learning systems. So the thing is, they have these very peculiar properties. For instance, they have twice the number of neurons as an adult brain. They are capable of, to a very high degree, adapting and being perceptive to very new ideas that change their entire belief systems. Because they don't have to drag decades of knowledge. They're not unbiased by decades of knowledge, which all are the ideal properties, I feel, of a researcher. It's just that, unfortunately, modern sciences have progressed so far that by the time these amazing minds are able to inherit so much ancestral knowledge, they are no longer the adorable blobs they started out to be. So the thing is that with AGI, this low prerequisite knowledge has allowed us for since a long time to once again deploy evolution's best researchers to the most important research problem of AGI. And all this is very relieving to me because remember, AGI comes with the potential for some of the greatest good in our lifetime, but it also comes with the potential for the most evil in the wrong hands. Because it's one of the most powerful technologies we know of. Except this time, mutually assured destruction isn't going to work like it did with nuclear weapons, because this time, the weapon itself can have a mind of its own. So, and the thing is, what better hands to trust with the creation of these powerful technologies than the hands of your own? All I could show you was a glimpse of the amazing things that I've seen and that's inspired me and hopefully will inspire you. Because with the right choices, I think you can actually find yourself in the midst of creating a mind that can think and live and feel like we do. And if nothing else, it's creating a mind, it's just cool. Thank you.